of administrative reform or in government. We had the pleasure to have him. He was with us last year, and we are very happy to have him this year as well, as this also shows how the local society is engaged in the Greek Policy Forum and is actually, I hope, welcoming us. Thank you very much.
My name is Xenia, I'm head of the foreign desk at Kathimerini Daily, and I'm moderating our last roundtable discussion. We will examine the subject of governance and policy responses. All the participants are either holding government posts or advising officials during a very difficult period, which calls for the implementation of the reform. So it will be interesting listening to their experience and discussing their response, their policies had in the public. There have been also some very interesting news today. The arrests of six Golden Dome member of parliaments. The leader of the far-right Golden Dome party, Nikos Mikhalouyakos, and the party spokesman, on charges of forming a criminal organization. So I think besides the crisis and everything we spoke about during those last 2 days, it would be interesting to hear from you your first reactions about those great news. Please be brief so that we don't engage in parallel monologues, but and have plenty of time for a really heated and interesting roundtable discussion. And please bear in mind, because there are politicians among us, that this discussion is on the record, so if you don't want to see yourself on the exit block news because of some provocative comments, beware. Thank you all for coming. And our first speaker is Mr. Pantelis, Kapsis, Deputy Minister of Public Radio and Television, journalist, and former Minister of State. Mr. Kapsis, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I want to thank the organizers for this invitation. It's the second year I'm here, and I'm already looking forward to the third one. My exposition will be based on our experience in Greece about the crisis, which has been taking place in the last 3 years, and we all know how serious it is. And I want to start with something that I'm sure you all know. The reports in the newspapers a few months ago about Angela Merkel, who apparently decided sometime during the summer of 2012 that she wants to support Greece to stay within the Eurozone. Of course, that to us wasn't real news, because we already knew that there were strong pressures in Europe for Greece to leave Europe. Actually, as most of you possibly know, sometime during Vangelis Venizelos was Minister of Finance. He had a meeting with Mr. Schäuble in Poland, where he formally proposed that Greece leaves Euro and it will get support from Germany to ease this transition to a national currency. Of course, Mr. Venizelos refused and resisted it. And to us, it seems a small miracle that we have managed to remain within Euro all these years, despite all the hardship. And it's also incredible because the pressures were not only from Europe, from some parts of Europe, but also from the inside, from inside Greece. And I had a small moment of epiphany last year when we had a meeting with what is called the social partners, when the Troika asked from the government to lower by law the minimum wage. And we had a meeting with the trade unions, and it went very well. Of course, they resisted it, but it was a very concrete and rational dialogue. And then we had a meeting with the small businesses, whom one would expect that they would support the government in its efforts to keep the country inside the Eurozone. And at the beginning, the dialogue was very mild, and different opinions were expressed. And then suddenly the president said, okay, and if Troika doesn't accept, let's leave the Euro. Let's go to our national currency. I was really amazed, because I thought, if these people don't support the Euro, then who supports the Euro? And I think this is the first point that I want to make, that the way the Greek society reacted to this crisis is unique. It's very different from the way Portugal, Spain, or Ireland reacted to this to this crisis. Let me give you some examples. First, it's the Conservative Party. When austerity measures were decided, the most outspoken critic of the measures was the Conservative Party, with a program that was completely unrealistic, the Zapion 1 and Zapion 2. This was the first thing. The second thing is that from the moment these things started, there were various theories circulating within Greek society that were more or less in the sphere of fantasy. For example, that the Troika and the IMF coming to Greece was the result of a dubious plot between the government and the IMF, while we have avoided this by getting money from Russia or I don't know, wherever place one could imagine. And then, of course, it's, I think, the only place in the world where the chief of the statistical office is under criminal, is facing criminal charges because he is accused of playing with the figures in order to force the country to go into the stabilization program and invite the IMF. What I mean to say is that suddenly, after this crisis erupted, the whole fringe political spectrum became mainstream in Greece. It's probably the exact opposite of what happened in Germany during the last elections. In Germany, we have a strengthening of the center. In Greece, we have a collapse of the center and a strengthening of fringe parties, one of which is, as you already know, I'm sure, is the Golden Dawn, a neo-Nazi party that whose leaders have been arrested this morning, and at last the law is being established in this case. So we had a completely different reaction. Even you academics know it better than myself, but even I guess fiscal multipliers were different in Greece than in other countries. And the depth of the crisis is much bigger in Greece. Now, why is that? One possible explanation is exactly because the crisis was so stronger and bigger in Greece, maybe that's why the reaction was so different. But I don't think this is true. And I don't think this is true because we had the signs of these events much earlier than the crisis. And of course, they were much stronger at the beginning when the crisis was not that big. My belief is, and I think that in this, a lot of people share it with me, that in Greece we have a completely different idea of what constitutes public interest. We have been a country that was agricultural 60 or 50 years ago and has modernized very quickly, and the idea of public interest, as has been established in practice, is that the state needs to safeguard the special privileges that various segments of society have. It starts from the top, the politicians. It goes to big business that always that almost live out of public procurements, and then it goes down and down. We are a country that, as some of you are lawyers here know, we have the highest ratio of lawyers to people in Greece. We have the, in the world, we have the highest ratio of judges to people in the world. We have double the number of pharmacies than, say, Belgium, which has a similar population. And we have the same number of teachers as the European, in terms of students, as the European Union has, but we depend on thousands of extras that are hired each year because the teachers don't teach. And this goes on and on. In almost all segments of society, they don't benefit the same way, but they all expect that their benefits is safeguarded by the state. So when you go on and try to introduce reforms, you have a very strong resistance. A special kind of privilege is tax evasion and corruption. Mr. Theoharis will talk about it, I suppose, in much greater length. But it is a privilege shared between the tax authorities that are bribed, and of course, the professionals and the small businesses that are very much into not paying their taxes. And of course, the same happens, for example, and this is, to my opinion, crucial, happens with the hospitals, where we have the famous institution of Fakilaki that you bribe doctors. Well, generally, in other societies, doctors are the apex of professionals to safeguard public morals. In Greece, they're corrupted, which is, again, something very distinctive for our society. And there's an anecdote which is supposedly attributed to Andreas Papandreou, the Prime Minister during the 80s, who said the following, which is indicative of why this happened. And he said that we've given the national health system to the doctors, and they hijacked it for their own interests. And this hijacking has happened all over Greece, all over the state sector. My exhibition wouldn't be complete if I wouldn't talk about the sector that I was involved in, the media. And there are many ways one can look at it. For one thing is that most media now are connected to special interests. But what is worse, and what makes an economic issue, the dislocation because of this special interest, makes it a political issue as well, is the way the media understand news. If you watch a Greek television program, news is something that is produced by a special interest group or a measure by the government that is commanded by a special interest group. The idea of public interest is completely, not completely, okay, but is mostly absent within the news. If we have corrupted political dialogue as well. Now, all this means that when the government started trying to introduce reforms that are necessary if we are to move away from this crisis, even though people voted for New Democracy and PASOK to constitute the government now, the reaction to the reform has been uniform. I don't want to make a judgment on the issue. It is a majority of the people that are against the reforms, but the reactions has been extremely strong, starting from the judges, moving to the armed forces, going to the teachers, of course to the universities. We know we have a special state in the universities where the rank of the universities was between some academics and some professional, semi-professional student unions that were imposing their will almost arbitrarily, without any regard to laws, to proper academic standards, or to anything else. Our academics here, I think, that can testify to that. So, very quickly, we had a strong reaction to the reforms, and at the same time, we were introducing reforms that were very badly and inefficiently executed. One cannot, after 3 years of very harsh measures in the state sector, nobody would maintain that the state sector is more efficient now than it was 3 years ago. It is less costly, that's true, but more efficient? No. What we are doing now, I think that we are basically playing for time. We are trying to overcome the deep end of the crisis and start growing again, in the expectation that people see that this is a viable and sustainable way ahead, and they will continue to support the government. I am saying that this is not enough. We need to first of all, take the ownership of the reforms. Don't appear to do them because the Troika commands them. And then when you take the ownership, you make your own priorities and have our own priorities in terms of growth on the one hand and social security on the other, because as George said yesterday, there are 400,000 families in Greece with no breadwinner at all. And out of 1,300,000 unemployed, only 300,000 get unemployment benefit, and this is something that is socially unacceptable. And if we do that, maybe we can get out of the crisis earlier and find the social support required for the reforms. Thank you.
I speak Spanish, but he likes humor next to me. He wants to give you an answer.
Actually, I have been asked by the organizers to say a few words on the issue of the day, that is the arrest and the issue of arrest warrants for MPs of Old and Dawn. And in fact, I'll say a few words. I must say a few words on what the minister just said. Quite frankly, I thought that the time that one could make a point by deploring the state that Greece is in was past. I think it's, in fact, to me, it seems quite a long time since officials and members of government, in fact, heads of government, could make a point just, demonizing the Greek society or public administration. Nevertheless, in fact, I think the issue which is currently under discussion is an issue which, in fact, we see today, and I can use this as a point of focus, I would say, by the short. Is that the focus can be that, in fact, Greece is operating like a normal state, normal European democracy, as we almost all want it to be. Since, as I told you, the organizers told me to say a few words regarding the news of the day, for those who possibly have not had the chance to follow the developments. We have had today the issuance of six arrest warrants for six Golden members of parliament, four of which have already been arrested. This is, in my opinion, as I told you, one of the, this is a piece of news that demonstrates that Greece is not a failed state, but Greece is a state in which the judiciary operates properly, efficiently. I think that's what will be evident after all this. Some people thought that the politics of that politics would interfere in the judiciary, but we see here that, in fact, the judiciary operates on its own without intervention, without anybody issuing decrees or starting legal reforms to make it work. And what is even more important for me, and I think this should kind of happen over the next few days, weeks, possibly, is that these developments will not result either to an overthrow of the government or to an early general election, or in any case, these developments will not lead to a change of track for Greece as a whole. Greece will continue on the path that it has chosen by the majority, as the minister rightly said. The majority of the people have voted for stability and continuation of integration within the European Union. I'm saying this, I'm stressing this, because in fact, there was quite a lot of noise over the last few weeks that, for instance, the MPs, the Golden Dawn MPs, would resign the seats, which would mean result in elections for each particular constituency in which they have been elected. So be it, if this is the case, according to the electoral law and on the basis of the constitution, what will happen is we'll have elections in a specific areas, in specific constituencies, and elections only for the seats that have been abandoned. Given that Golden Dawn is not the first in the constituency, it's not the first parliament constituency, this would mean that Golden Dawn gets out of the parliament and the seats would be divided amongst the rest. It is absolutely certain that some of the seats, even if it's not the majority, will go to the parties that are in government, if polls are to be trusted, and they are, I believe they are, some seats will go to the Central Party, possibly some, most likely some seats will also go to Syriza, which should be all know. This would not undermine stability in any way, because the overall majority that the two parties that I have now have, in fact, will be further augmented. There will be a few seats on top of the majority we already have. So this is, I mentioned in the beginning, the judiciary aspect. The political aspect also shows that Greece, in fact, is on the road to stability, is on the road to implementing the reforms that the Greek electorate has voted for, and the reforms that we all judge to be absolutely necessary. And even though we have a very difficult road ahead, it's absolutely certain that it's not all over. Most likely, we're not almost halfway where we are aiming to go. Nevertheless, we are on the right way, and we already see a few signs on the side of the economy, as well as I mentioned, given what we've seen over the last couple of weeks on the political and social area, I'm referring to polls which you might have had the chance to have a look at, or you can very easily see them. So, overall, the very hard process in which we have embarked is working. We absolutely need to have support from our partners, and there's no other way. It must be understood that the Greek society has come to its limits, possibly has exceeded its limits, the limits of what the stamina of the social state that are financially weaker that can be. This means that when, if all goes well, by the end of the year, we have a confirmed primary surplus, which will be the most important landmark and the greatest achievement of this three-year very hard, this three-year period, which has been very hard. When we achieve this, and when this is confirmed, we will expect to see some flexibility on the part of our partners. Flexibility, not mind you, at least my personal opinion, flexibility should not mean that we must be softer on necessary reforms. Not at all. The structural reforms are reforms that should have been, in fact, undertaken a lot prior to the crisis. This is something that we cannot contest. In fact, this is something on which I would agree with the Deputy Minister. So, when I'm talking about flexibility, I do not mean flexibility. I do not mean a softening of the effort for structural reform. I mean, in fact, flexibility on understanding the way that it is possible to achieve financial and quantitative targets. So, given that it is impossible to impose additional measures of financial and fiscal effect on the majority of the population, this set of society, this must be taken into account, but this must lead to an understanding between Greece and its partners that will take into account the social aspect. I think, given this, we will manage. Greece is on its way to recovery, and since I've seen a few of you last year in this exactly the same venue, I can tell you that I wished last year, I remember that, I wished that next year when we meet things would be better. And in fact, they are better, because we are not anymore afraid that we are on the verge of collapse, we're on the verge of becoming a failed state. We did not become a failed state, we will succeed on the road to recovery. Thank you.
General Secretary for Public Revenues. I'll try to keep my comments brief so that we leave more time for the discussion. But let me start with a disclaimer. I'm not said it, so I'm absorbed in all sins of what will follow. Why? After all, we're still in a crisis and a very deep one. But I would say that we're not wasting it to answer the old battle, but the crisis is a terrible thing to waste. I think we do have progress. It's not a linear progress. After all, we had to lift the capitals thrice before actually doing it. And it's not a progress that doesn't have a huge, huge cost, but it's progress nevertheless. This year, the fiscal side of the progress is obvious. It wasn't last year. And the fiscal side, the fiscal progress was done in a pro-cyclical fashion, which makes it much, much harder than what it would have been. Structural is not so obvious, but I believe it will be the same way that fiscal progress that was happening last year, and I remind that we overperformed in terms of the program in 2012 even by €1 billion, and it wasn't obvious until the very end, and I think structural will be obvious towards the end of this year as well. Or perhaps in the next months. The OECD reports are already showing it, showing that Greece is making huge progress in the structural changes it's making. And I think the creation of the GSPR, the General Secretary for Public Revenue, is a living example. As with everything, it had a long gestation period, but it's here with us. For the first time, we are splitting policy and administration of that policy, and it's making everyone have a headache. I think more than half the people that come to me with problems don't understand that I don't have any sway over policy, except if I talk to ministers as an individual. And they come to me to fix this problem with the tax and raise the schedule and the tax year, the rates, or do. Create exceptions to the tax laws, and this is obviously something that I'm not dealing with. From what I understand, the Deputy Minister Mavroianis, who is responsible for that, has about 50% of his time with people saying, you know, asking for tax administration issues to be fixed. So I'm sure we'll get our heads around this at some point. The position is for a 5-year term, which is again something which is very different than what the country has been used to up to now. The delegation of authorities are revocable, so anything the minister, any power the minister delegates to the GSPR, he cannot take back. And we have been striving for exceptions in a number of rules. always coming up with constitutional issues of whether this is allowed, and the Secretary General to be able to have budget autonomy, meaning that I can move funds from one budget line to another within the financial envelope that's given to us. Hiring rules, we still operate with a set, but we set all the standards of how the hiring happens within limits, obviously. Promotion, grading, job grading, basically a lot of exceptions to the codes of public sector employees, which are very, very difficult to negotiate all these months, and hopefully we're going to be finishing the next few weeks. A final part is that is still to be completed is the integration of all the games dealing with tax and customs issues, but hopefully this will be under our belt in the next month or two. I will close my remarks because up to now I strategically avoided the question of whether we did this on our own or whether we were goaded to it. And I don't mean the silly and perhaps suspect question of sovereignty. We are making the changes ourselves. We are underwriting the final result, even if we are in agreement with our partners in terms of the goals of those changes. But those changes in a formal and substantial function are our own. But rather the real question, whether we will do it, left to our own devices. And this is not easy to answer. And even though my personal answer is that probably is negative, I think I should submit that it doesn't matter. The effects will be just as real.
Mr. Dimitris Katsikas is head of the ELIAMEP crisis observatory.
Thank you. I'd like to thank also the organizers for inviting me here. I'd also like to clarify that I'm not a political position or budget position with the government. I'm a researcher at the independent think tank, and I'm getting this new initiative, the crisis observatory, started this year. So I think it will be more critical. Well, the organizing committee has asked me to talk about research. It's an issue we haven't touched upon during this, and actually most, despite significance, most similar meetings about the crisis these past few years. And I think it's very important because I think the roundtable is policy and governance and ways to get out of the crisis in the future. And I think Greece has a serious deficit in this area. It's a deficit no one speaks about. It's a deficit in research outcomes and policy. It's very significant because it's a prerequisite, I think, for Greece's economic recovery and sustainable growth strategy in the future. I have to say that this is not a new phenomenon. Greece has not, has never had a tradition of research. I've never been a hub of research of innovation, unfortunately, and has nothing to do with the crisis. For example, the expenditure in R&D has been very, very low. In 1999, it's been actually declining as well, although starting from a very low basis. 6% of GDP. After the adoption of the Lisbon agenda, where the target was 6% of GDP, we actually managed to go downwards to 0.55% of GDP in 2004. And the last official number is 0.58% in 2007, and this by itself is one of the last available numbers after 2007. By comparison, top performers in this area, like Sweden and Finland, invest between 3.5% and 4% of the GDP each year in R&D, and the European average is about 2% of both euros and European average. Apart from the lack of funding, there's also a major problem in Greece with the institutional framework, which is basically the same as it was in the 1980s. The original framework has been some attempts to reform it. They have all failed, and we'll come back to that again later. I think the research policy issue is very significant. not only for the future of the country, but also because, in my mind, it's behind three major causes of this crisis. It has to do with the major, three major ways to the crisis we're experiencing. As you point out, in my mind, the crisis is not economic. The economic crisis is only the symptom of deeper social and political crisis in this country. The first way, the lack of research policy and research institutes in Greece has contributed to the crisis is something which is very public, we see every day. And it's the lack of the poor level of public discourse about the crisis. Now we're in the sixth year of crisis, of recession, and 3 years, more than 3 years after the Troika game, the Lusan memorandum, and still public discourse, especially from political parties and the media, is very poor. It's conducted on the basis of slogans and aphorisms, no real evidence-based discussion, no concrete arguments are heard. And this is a major issue. There is no tradition, unfortunately, of active civil society. Think tanks are scarce, their voice is not heard, their research is not really publicized. The term researcher for the general public in Greece is an unknown word. If you go around and ask what does a researcher do, nobody will know what to answer. And this is a huge deficit. And I think has played a major role in the appearance of extreme phenomena like the golden dawn. Because once the general audience is accustomed to this kind of public discourse, golden dawns or other parties' slogans sometimes are much more attractive than mainstream party slogans. You know, if it's a concept of slogans we are down to. And indeed, the crisis observatory, this initiative that ELIAMEP, I'm involved with, motivation was actually that we need to have a forum and we're intended to spread information, independent information, and evidence based, and typically produced information that can be brought freely and free of charge to the general public. Now, the second major harm of this lack of research policy and research initiatives in Greece has to do with reforms, public policy reforms. The minister talked about resistance to reforms from special interest groups. I totally agree, I don't understand that, but this is not the only reason, that not only during this crisis, but more generally throughout. Recent history, public reforms have not been successful. Another very important reason is that they have been ill-designed. And they have been ill-designed reforms repeatedly because they were not based on solid research. Ministries do not have serious research departments. Even if they have research institutes, they usually involve with much lower level of policy issues, technical issues, not only wider. So these issues of policy direction. Even they somehow, either independently or because the minister asked them for a report or a study of some kind, they haven't produced this kind of major policy issue study. This is traditionally ignored by the political leadership. And scholars only do anyway what they want to do. On the advice of advisors, which again, typically are not real researchers. Most of the times, maybe family members, friends, or whatever else, the minister. They don't have a real problem of solid, scientifically backed strategic studies of how to conduct family reforms in Greece. And the third way in which this lack of research capabilities has the most obvious, obviously, has to do with the crisis, is the effect on the economy. As in the last couple of decades, all international institutions have produced studies that display and demonstrate how important these investments in knowledge, in innovation, in recent technology and development. Unfortunately, in Greece, this has not happened, as has been said repeatedly these couple of days. The Greek economic model was not sustainable, it was dependent on domestic consumption. musical systems reports or large scale search revision, all the passable through borrowing. No exponential growth in the past, no upward orientation, no investments in innovation and technology. Indeed, studies have shown that, and of course, it was unsustainable because studies have shown that the countries, advanced countries that have the most sustainable high growth rates, are countries that typically invest either equally or more in material resources such as education, research, and so on, innovation, rather on physical investments, factories, simply, whatever else. And of course, during this crisis, the lack of research in Greece, more significant issue because during crisis, what happens is the private sector stops funding research. This is because at least part of its research reduces expenditure on research because some of the projects, especially basic research projects, are long term with certain results. So in crisis, private companies need to focus on saving cash right now. And of course, especially in financial crisis, and this is also a financial crisis, they do not have access to credit to invest long term on research projects. And therefore, this is where the state should come in and fill that gap in times of crisis. The state should fund research in times of crisis, not withdraw funding. Because it risks, if it doesn't do so, country risks damaging permanently its research capabilities in the long term. We already see evidence of this in Greece. We have this very much talked about, but there is a little research about issue of brain drain. Everybody knows that there is a flow, migration flow from Greece and other southern peripheral countries to the core as a result of the crisis. We had in Apia, ELIAMEP hosted a European conference and had some preliminary results that the European universities with network of other universities is making, which say that 85% of people living in Greece are high skilled young people. Most of them actually with master's degrees or PhD. And therefore, this creates a serious problem for the future of research capabilities in this country. And similar findings again for other countries. We also see, and we discussed some of this more in the Q&A session, past examples of countries like South Korea, Finland, or Sweden that have invested through crisis and exit crisis through investment in R&D and innovation. Unfortunately, and this is a critical part of the government, this has not happened during crisis in Greece. On the contrary, I'm afraid the Greek government, admittedly under intense pressure from the Troika, has cut expenses across the board and has treated R&D and education more generally as well as any other public expense, and has cut substantially university budgets, the already low salaries of academics, and of course frozen new hirings and etc. Just to finish, I think a major thing of the panel, major reforms are needed in the government's policy. This has to do, for example, with linking university and the research community with the markets, providing a framework for venture capital, which is not existing in Greece. In 2009, for example, venture capital investments in Greece in high risk technology projects was 5 million. The year before, it was 400,000 in the whole country. We need a strategy in sectors to invest in specific sectors, a better evaluation of exposure, ex ante as well, and of course, funding. Much, much more funding in Portugal. Have been following a reverse course. It's now about 1.5% of the GDP they're investing in R&D, despite their difficulties. So I think there is another way out, and this can have short-term effects as well on the coming election. Thank you.
Thank you very much for hosting us. congratulations for the great initiative. Looking forward to the next GPPF next year. I have, besides my academic background in political science and public administration, I have also worked for the Greek government from 2009 to 2011, the Ministries of Public Order and the Ministry of Economy and Competitiveness. So what I'm going to talk about summarizes my experience and my somehow current involvement in the civil society and our effort to politicize the debate in Greece right now. So how will Europe look ahead? How will Greece make the necessary transition? Things that we discussed about. In the event of the forthcoming European election, the always existing scenario of an early Greek general election, the entry of new leaders in the EU institutions, as David illustrated yesterday, a possible new constitutional convention. I would like to briefly put on the table a series of thoughts that may provoke more discussion afterwards. Let me begin with some thoughts on the EU. According to a recent study by Oxfam, an additional 15 to 25 million Europeans on the existing 120 million poor people could face the prospect of living in poverty by 2025. Austerity, a zombie economic area, as some thinkers have characterized it, poses a direct threat against the social and political fabric of the peripheral states, as we witness in Greece, and perpetuates and exacerbates economic weakness, inequality, and joblessness in Europe. By punishing the profligate, the governments of the EU diminish the potential of the middle class to save, invest, and maintain a decent level of social services and needed to secure social mobility. Moreover, sovereignty, as we knew it in the past, becomes more porous. Lack of legitimacy undermines the state's capacity to maintain its sovereignty, and people lose confidence in domestic and international political institutions. I'm not sure if you're aware of the latest Pew Institute's research on Euroscepticism in France, in Portugal, and Greece. French people are more Eurosceptic than the Greeks right now. The implications for democracy are more than evident, especially as we witness it in Greece. I'm afraid that they will become more bitter in the near future, especially in the forthcoming European elections. Yorgos mentioned yesterday, Yorgos from Vlachos, that fragmented policy response to the crisis at the EU level has created more hazards and contraction than possibly anticipated. Although we have reasons to believe that the polemic between the proponents of austerity and the proponents of new Keynesian stimulus might not offer too much in the case of our country, still we have no credible answer, and maybe our economists here might help us to clarify why the EU chose the path of growth-friendly fiscal consolidation as the GA characterized in 2008 against the American recovery path after 2008. So what should be done? Arguably, we need a new institutional architecture combined with a banking and fiscal union. The unfinished building has been continuously posed before. However, a new political economy for the union, the member states, could be promoted through the new single market, focusing on technology, innovation, the empowerment and the interconnectivity of the SMEs, the provision of incentives for more people to start their own businesses. I believe that the involvement of the European Investment Bank and the European Investment Fund is good news for the Greek and the European entrepreneurs, and that's why we believe that its role should be enhanced in the future. European governments need the right direction of focus and the provision of technical, political, and financial support to the ailing states. For instance, the technical support provided to Greece by the task force should not exhaust its potential as another pet project of the European League and the President of the European Commission, but it should expand its scope and integrate the knowledge of the national administrations. In the case of Greece, the Troika schema has exhausted its potential. Recorded inconsistencies between the objective of structural reforms, as these reforms are enhanced and assisted by a number of international organizations and EU member states, and the IMF objectives, namely the deficit and the current account balance. All these derail the role of the administration and hamper strategic execution every 3 months, as we mentioned yesterday. A new vehicle, a new Troika, or a new European bill, as we can call it in the future, should reconcile the indebted states with European solidarity and the reform process. What about Greece, to be more precise? Greek policies should target unemployment and in-work poverty, which is structural and long-term, and hits people at their 50s and at their 20s. countries implementing austerity to regulate their labor markets in order to introduce flexibility, which is the case right now. However, flexibility in the Greek market is not only associated with the absence of social protection measures, but it's accompanied with the coexistence of informal, black economies, you name it, plus the erosion of social bargaining systems. What we still experience in Greece is that bank recapitalization has not been, and probably will not be, transformed into a new policy of loans, adjusted to the needs of the real economy and the competitive and surviving SMEs. Today, if you want to start a small business, access to seed funding or microcredit is extremely problematic. Small businesses' marginal costs are so high that even in our favorite tourist sector, they often find no incentives to enter the official economy, pay their taxes, and the social insurance contributions. A fair distribution of the tax burden is something we need, and I'm sure Harris will further elaborate. According to 2011 data, wage earners and pensioners pay for almost 55% of the overall tax revenues, where the self-employed, the professionals, and autonomous workers pay for almost 16% accordingly. People at risk of poverty in Greece has exceeded 20% of the population. However, the figures do not include home ownership or self-consumption, The most problematic dimension is that there are no data about the distribution of land and property. It is impossible to detect the value of mobile assets, and there is a lack of information on real estate and other assets. So we need more open data. Finally, unfair income distribution diminishes the ability of the middle class to save and invest, as I mentioned before. Export-led growth, as we mentioned before. Our current account deficit has been decreased mainly due to the collapse of imports. Now we experience the gradual decrease of our exports. Despite our integration in the single market, our economy has not been sufficiently diversified, leading to what you and Ioni mentioned before, the surplus of non-tradable products and services that maintain this, as we call it, entrepreneurship of necessity instead of entrepreneurship of opportunity. Times call for a pan-European intergenerational pact, a new social contract founded on what Ed Woodberg mentioned, that society is a contract and the state is a partnership between those who are living, those who are dead, and those who are to be born. This call for solidarity has various dimensions. Please let me focus on the public debt dimension. The heart of the matter is that the accumulation of debt is on the expense of the younger generation. Only the sums of debt owned in the form of government bonds are calculated, often leaving outside the unfunded liabilities of wealthy cities. The problem is that golden constitutional rules and fiscal pacts, as we witnessed with the two-pack and the six-pack, will be easily violated or potentially violated by the propensity of governments to spend more. However, new practices in the public sector in the form of publicized balance sheets and the adoption of globally accepted accounting templates will avert state failures in the future and promote more accountability. Of course, the same principle applies to the privatization of public goods like water or electricity, the industrial policy and growth model, the management of natural resources, the quality of life in urban centers, the reform of pension schemes, and the labor market. This constitutes a huge intergenerational solidarity agenda. Finally, let me finish with this. Allow me to highlight that the major problem of the European political powers today is the belief, the political conviction, that there is no alternative to austerity and the side effects of globalization. Centrist and progressive political powers in Europe have been locked up in economic and in political superstition. In the case of Greece, this superstition leaves room to the unfiltered adoption of measures proposed by international organizations like the IMF, the World Bank, and the European Commission in the absence of our own national plan. Finally, as a progressive, I cannot avoid referring to the social and electoral retreat of social democracy in Europe. Following half a century of successful tax and transfer, public investment, and inclusive welfare, the social democrats wake up in a reality where the social cement, in other words, money, is sparse. The dependence of endowments are vulnerable towards the populace, and the public sector still provides, as we say, 40-style services of poor quality, especially in my country. If the progressives in Europe are looking for a new electorate, they need to redirect the focus from the old industrial and public sector employee to the educated unemployed, the socially vulnerable, the world of the SMEs and the self-employed, the ones who are frustrated and skeptical with Europe, but at the same time have the energy, the talent, and the enthusiasm today to move things forward. The same ambition that applies to Europe applies to Greece as well. The mobilization of civil society, as you mentioned before, through the means of voluntary associations, social work, social economy, the existing networks of social solidarity that flourish in the cities and in our regions right now, I think they constitute the seeds of the social capital, we need social capital, to renew the quality of public policies and politics in my country. Thank you.
So
that we have almost 40
minutes for our Q&A session.
It's a question or a point, maybe the task ahead of us, which indirectly or directly was brought up in the contributions we had just now. There is a lack of a Greek ownership or Greek vision of the changes that take place. At the same time, there is a conundrum that already the system, the political system, needs to take decisions and indeed does take decisions that bear tremendous political cost. Any Greek vision, any understanding of the future radically different from the present is bound to generate additional political costs to the one already being undertaken in the framework of our agreements with our creditors. So my question to you is how we resolve this issue, because ownership of change also entails costs. And the system, as Mr. Poulidakis told us, not only the tolerance of the Greek people that is distinct, I would suspect that Greek people are even more resilient than they've already proved. It's tolerance of our political leadership that is in its very limits. The question is, how can when the system has already reached its limits in terms of the political cost, can assume, how can it yet extend its limits by giving a Greek definition, a Greek flash to the changes that need to be undertaken in the future?
Yeah, so I would like to start with a remark. Actually, the only elected official on the panel just left. The rest of you are appointed. Right? But I'm very grateful for the fact that you all formulated a long-term vision for this country. My question is, how can a democracy formulate a long-term vision in the midst of a crisis with very pressing short-term demands and questions?
I have a question, stroke remark for Ms. Katsikas concerning the issue of research and funding of research and the design of past reforms. I think it's true to say that the previous reforms were and still are less than perfectly designed. But if you go down to it, you see that the reason is a lack of data, fragmentation, opacity, intentionally hiding the evidence. And of course, research is a big category, but if you focus on economic and socio-economic research, it needn't cost that much, but it cannot be done unless you provide the data. And it is interesting that nobody knew the exact number of the civil servants, so who can do qualitative and quantitative research on public administration? And those who thought they did, because they had bits and pieces of fragments of catalogs and lists, they didn't know the age of these civil servants. So how can you plan for pensions and ahead in terms of, and of course, the complete opacity of the social security funds. Nobody knows exactly how many the pensioners are. They know how many pensions they give out, but this does not mean that they know the number of pensions. And so all this kind of stuff does not lead to it's not directly linked to the lack of funds going for social research, but it is linked to a kind of attitude that the less you know, the better clear for you and for us. So, I mean, this is another trait where the political and the ideological sort of contaminates even good intentional people who like to do it.
Very interesting debate here. And, what I was going to say was in the same line. It's very difficult to do research without data, and there is this problem. It's not only in Britain. Well, you can see it in the US Minister in England, but of course it's much serious in Greece. And there was a lot of this problem when I was in the finance ministry. We had to fight a lot. The tendency of the ministries to not reveal all the data. Because I know that if we study the data, we will find ways of cutting, of reducing redundancies, of reducing expenses that make no sense and so on. But even if they make no sense, there's a lot of sense in a lot of ministries of property that this belongs to us and we don't really need it, but we don't want to lose it. And this is quite difficult to address this issue, but I think transparency and more data is the way to go. And the ideas that Dimitris brought us about research and public debate, I think are very important. In Portugal, the academics have done a lot of this role, and they have some influence in the media and in the society, and I think that helped a lot in some of the reforms. And ministers felt obliged, because they took ownership of some of the reforms, they felt obliged to go to academics because they knew that what they were reforming would be popular, so they want to sustain that in data and evidence and so on, not as an excuse but as a way of avoiding making stupid mistakes and as a way of having some support from the opinion makers and so on. You mentioned Portugal. We really had a huge increase in the spending in R&D. In these last 2 years, it's a bit decreasing. But the good news is that the spending that we had in R&D made by the government generated more spending in R&D in firms. And these days, we are spending much more in R&D in firms than by the government, which is makes it more sustainable and makes that the spending in R&D is having a direct impact in competitiveness, which was part of the role that we wanted. I had several other things here, but I'm not going to comment. Just one thing about the American and the I addressed that, the American and the austerity chosen by the Europeans. I think there's a cost there, and there's like, it was quoted here, the 7%, 25%, and 50%. But the funny thing with these numbers, if you divide Europe on half on the north-south basis, you put 3.5% and 3.5% of the population, and then you put a bit more of the GDP in the north part. But you put much more of the spending in social. And these are the competitive countries. So the idea of, to be competitive, we have to destroy all the support from the state, is a completely wrong idea, which doesn't mean that we need to reform the state, and some of the part that needs to be reformed is like pensions and subsidies and so on. That the main problem is not only the size, that a lot of them cumulative goes to some people, and there's a lot of people left out in Greece. That is a huge problem that was mentioned. I think there's no easy solution to this, but these solutions are always fake, and there are people that thought that austerity was the solution, and it's unfortunate that got. Thank you very much.
I was just reminded when William the Conqueror made the Christianity in 1066, the first thing he did was to establish the Boone State Book, which was an account of what the country had, and it was seen as the start of good administration. Let's just imagine, because the thing which worries me most about the current situation in Greece is actually the brain drain of the young. You're losing your future. And probably around the table we've got a bit of that brain drain here coming back just for the weekend.
Only brain, no brain.
If I were a fairy godmother and you granted one wish, and it was in order to bring your brightest and best back to stay there. What would you ask for? It's the one thing you think could bring you young back.
From an investor's perspective, the change that you described regarding the collection of the revenue is the epitome of structural changes that it should have happened, and it seems that it has happened. Could you clarify how the head of your desk is appointed? What is the procedure in order to appoint you, and whether, you know, through Parliament there has to be an agreement from the political parties? Secondly, the role of your office, does it have any similarity with the Office of Budget Responsibility in the UK? Do you also, I know that the Office of Budget Responsibility is not responsible for collection of taxes, but you are responsible for that. But are you, will your office provide numbers and calculations for any suggestions from the political parties in the Parliament? Whenever they say that I'm going to increase this spending, will you provide a report saying that this is going to be the effect on the budget, and then let the Parliament vote on that? My third question is for Mr. Pavulato, and then I would like also Mr. Kapsi to answer. Can you see under any macroeconomic analysis for the country that the country will resume growth? And assuming that the lenders of this country, they prolong even more the debt repayment and they decrease even more the interest rates, I'm taking out the option of a complete write-off. Do you actually believe that the country can resume growth and at certain stage find debt sustainability? And depending on your answer, I would like to see the comment of Mr. Kapsi about the vision of the country.
I'd like to start from Giliato's challenging question. Thank you for giving me it's really something I don't think anyone can provide an answer from the ground of certainty. What we do know is that that burden has to be alleviated in order to have a chance for a sustainable recovery. What we do know is that structural reforms have to continue in order for us to have a chance for that, and the private budget surplus has to be also sustainable after being achieved probably this year. Now, with regard to the first, I agree with you that we would not be expecting anything more than an extension of maturities and a reduction of interest rates, and I think we shouldn't be expecting more. Given the fact that anything more than that, touching the principle, would be really toxic in the Eurozone framework. But that would be enough, provided that we have a debt profile that would, the debt servicing burden that would be really low, and that markets would actually view not the debt to GDP ratio as such, which would remain high for many, many years, but the actual debt servicing. Would amount to a sort of perpetual debt, which would be there, but the markets, semi-perpetual debt, but the markets would perceive, and the analysts would perceive, that the country has the potential to carry it out, as long as the interest rate remains low, as low as possible, and that can be fixed, because most of this debt, vast majority of it is sufficient. And the growth rate is higher than that interest rate, the nominal growth rate. Now, coming to that, I think we have two things there. We have the need for a framework of macroeconomic stability and fiscal sustainability, and this comes through the commitment of delivering primary budget surpluses in a sustained manner. I remind you that the greater difficulty is with reaching the primary budget surplus, not sustaining. Of course, in our case, we have reached it through ways that may not be sustainable. For example, by deferring arrears to the private sector, or by achieving one-off sort of tax revenues that cannot be repeated in the future,
without severe losses for our productive capacity and the growth potential of the country. So there is a certain difficulty there that even if we achieve primary budget surplus this year, which I think we will, there's a great challenge in sustaining it for next year and the year after that. Structural reforms are very important, and I would stress among them, at the top among them, is not the labor market reforms, which I think we've gone as far as we could, but it's also reforms in terms of competition in the area of services, the functioning of professions, the ability to be able to start up a company, removing all the kind of bureaucracy that comes on the way. By the way, just to put a brief break on this national self-flagellation to which we have voted over the last two days, and I'm happy to participate in that, always if you're in a Greek audience. But just to put a brief break on that, Greece is not the only country that has problems with services market. And one of the countries that by any commission report, continues to have very severe barriers in entering the service and professional markets in Germany and many other countries in Europe. I do not mean to make any comparison here, but let's attempt to leave this ethnocentrism aside for a while, because many times I happen to participate in such conferences, and we tend to believe that we are the most, we live in the most corrupt, incompetent, hopeless, political system or state in the world or in Europe at least, and this is not the case. This is not the case. I was speaking to an Italian friend of mine who was describing me the kind of corruption that goes on in the Italian system, which somehow dreads the arrival of any troika. But he also said that if the troika went and to the Italian system, the challenge that it would have to face would mean that all the obstacles that have been laid before it by the Greek politicians and bureaucrats would amount to nothing compared to what it would actually be faced with if it were to face Italian politicians and the Italian status quo. So let's leave this national sort of introspection for a while. We are not unique, the problems are not unique. And in fact, this leads me to the second point I wish to make, that the greatest problem in the Eurozone, I think, is two things, it's a twofold thing. First, it is to reverse the fragmentation that we have been witnessing over the last 3 years. I remind you that until 2008-2009, European markets, institutions, analysts were viewing the Eurozone as a single economy. They even went as far as believing that the risk premium on the Greek bonds compared to the German Bund, was justified to be 30 basis points, which is obviously overstated on the optimistic side. But now we've been led to exactly the opposite extreme, that the markets and the analysts and institutions are viewing the Eurozone as a completely fragmented economy. And this cannot go on. This cannot go on because this will be operating as a self-fulfilling prophecy, will be constantly exercising procyclical impact, amplifying recession, make it impossible for the Eurozone institutions, banks, markets, companies of the periphery to go back to a sustainable track. It will lock them into an interest rate differential of 3, 4, 5 percentage points above the core, and that is not sustainable. Whether this will break in 1 or 2 or 3 or 5 years or 10 years, no one knows, but it's not sustainable. I remind you that the countries in the periphery entered the Eurozone back 10 or 15 years ago, for two main things. Well, of course, it was the promise of macroeconomic stability. Fiscal stability was the promise of low inflation, was the promise of low interest rates. We're back to fiscal stability, we're back to low inflation. We had a higher inflation differential throughout this period. We're converging now, but we have to go back also to reasonably low interest rates, and that can only happen through moving forward to banking integration. But the second thing I think is very important is for the whole Eurozone architecture and structures and frame of mind to incorporate, to absorb the principle of counter-cyclicality, if I may put it in this awkward way. What I mean to say by that is that the one problem today is that the periphery is forced to implement austerity, fiscal consolidation reforms when it is at the downstream. This is a very ill-advised thing to do. And the second next ill-advised thing to do is that the periphery lost the opportunity to implement reforms when it was on the upswing. We need reforms, pressure for reforms, when the economies are growing. That's when the government should not be let away from the European Union institutions. We should have reformed our pension system, our public administration, our wage system, at the time when we had the highest growth rate, and that would have allowed us to have a more sustainable path to recovery and more growth-friendly exit from the crisis. Sorry, Madam Chair.
Mr.
Kapsis.
Did you answer the growth thing? Anyway, I'll start from the first question by Mr. Kamaras and similar question for later. Of course, we have to take the ownership of the program, we incur costs and risks, of course, that are very difficult. But then, up to now, we have been muddling through, saying that we'll manage, and to a large extent, this has happened by aggravating the problems all the time. I think, indeed, even from those people that are against the reforms, they realize that we need to do something different now, and we need to change. So, if we take the ownership, and if we have clear priorities, I think this is very important. If we can create some sort of social support to a political program of reform, then yes, we can do it. The alternative would have been again to muddle through and then at some later point to make the same mistake again and try to bring back what we are leaving behind now. This is not feasible. So even though it's a very difficult task and coming from the center left, I think the center left have paid the greatest cost of that, we still need to be even more clear and in what we are trying to do. That's my first reply. The second reply, if I met a fairy, what would I ask her for against the brain drain? I have a different way of looking at that. I think that young Greeks that go abroad to Europe to study and then to work, possibly, this is what has been happening in Greece for decades now. And I look at it because I face it as a personal problem. My son is studying abroad, and I told him, okay, you stay there and work for at least some years and then come back. I see it as a Noah's Ark. We maintain our potential. We maintain our potential in Europe. And then when things are better, be sure that they are attracted back to Greece. It's difficult to keep them away, actually. More difficult to keep them away coming back and say, find a job. So, although I fully agree that it is a problem in Greece, I think that at the moment there is no possibility of being here. It's better for them to go abroad and then be a capital, human capital that we can exploit. Coming to the growth thing. Okay, I said that we are playing for time and we hope that we'll be able to attain higher, some positive rates of growth, and the whole outlook will change, and this will make it easier for the Greek people to accept the policies of the government. I also want to stress another point. What's the alternative? The alternative is to go back to the national currency. This has been argued many times by economists all over the world, and I can understand their point. And under ideal circumstances, I would have been able to discuss it. But please don't forget that leaving the euro for Greece is a political problem, not an economic problem. And I really do not believe that society would have been able to overcome the shock that such a decision would have meant. We already see that the political situation in Greece is very delicate. Under different circumstances, possibly one could discuss. Nowadays, I think it has been a very dangerous path for Greek democracy. Thank you.
Let me try. Well, actually, as a parenthesis, an answer, not an I think under ESA rules and the modified cash accounting, a year or so over 90 days count in our deficit. So we won't be able to use that rules to lower our fake primary surplus. Now the easy answer is about the technical issues of the position. The appointment of the Secretary General is done by the Minister of Finance. The previous process was an open process, so there was a call for CVs. But there's nothing precluding the next process not to have a call, just be appointed by the Minister, presumably with cooperation with the Prime Minister's office. We don't have any mandates to give reports comparing the policy or towards the Parliament. What we do have is that we need to create an annual strategic report in terms of the state of the tax administration, what we have been doing and what we will be doing in the next year at least. So this is the main responsibility that we have towards Parliament, referring to the Parliament and planning this report. However, we are setting up a new organization charts that we're creating currently. We're setting up a policy unit, not to create a policy, obviously, although it will suggest solutions in the tax matters to the ministers, but mainly to analyze and see where our problems are, tax accounts, and then everything, abilities to pay, and all those studies that would allow us to see what policy changes will make the revenue collection easier. Remembering the other questions. There was a question about how a democracy can have a long-term vision in the midst of a crisis. Perhaps it shouldn't. It shouldn't have a long-term vision in the midst of a crisis. It should just deal with the crisis. And having the luxury of a long-term vision means that the crisis is over. And I think this is roughly the point where we are. And if I tie this to your question and tell us about the lack of ownership, it's exactly the point, I think, in our discussions with our partners, that we should, I think we should take much more of a prominent role in terms of what the measures are and the ownership of those measures. I've been reading this even in the news in terms of the Ministry of Administrative Reform. It's more reasonable way, and I think we're doing this in the Ministry of Finance as well, in terms of what we are doing. And I have a concrete example from the discussions that I had even yesterday with our technical advisors on the new organizational structure. We have specific ideas on how the structure will be, which were not surprising a bit, so they're trying to do research on purpose and see how we can make this work. So this is actually a very nice place to be, to be in control. I've been feeling since January that I took this place that I'm always behind the stipulations of this agreement or that agreement. And now we're beginning to have a bit more control and adding a few points in the mix. Hopefully, we're still not in a place, in a position to have finished all the basic changes in the administration, meaning that we have a lot of noise, and that's making our life difficult to have targets and follow those. But it's very reassuring to see that we have to do our part in the budget, and we have budget numbers without creating difficulties while we're doing so basic changes like closing 60% of our tax offices, changing the organizational structure, putting a new rating and promotion system. I mean, all those things that you can imagine are creating insecurity in our personnel, difficulty. People are moving files around instead of actually doing work. So all that is, I think, encouraging for this year, and hopefully it will lead to better results next year and years ahead. I'll just say a word about the lack of data. We think so as well. I'm sure people can solve this problem to do research without data. So I'm sure. But more seriously, I would like to learn different areas of your research. We'd like to point you to our website, publicreview.gr, where we're trying to publicize the way the administration works. So, for example, we have data about the VAT refunds there per tax office and how many cases they have open, how much time that you're waiting, average days between an application and payment, and other data is useful. Now, with the personal income tax audits, we have the information about how many people have entered the tax office or sent the data. What's the backlog and all that? So hopefully it will lead to a more transparent operation of the tax administration and focus people to put the pressure where it should be. Because if you have data, you can judge where we're doing right correctly or where not. Yes, one wish to bring the game back. I'm not sure I have. For the very good mother, but being someone that studied and worked abroad before coming back to Greece, I'm hoping that this will work like the tentacles of an octopus, who is sending them out and bringing them back in. So I think what's really important is for the people that stay back to do our job correctly and make this a place where actually it's fun and it's also a good thing to work here. So hopefully this will really call people back and stop the other generation that's coming after them from leaving if they have to. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. I think cross-pollination with other nations, it's always a good thing, so but obviously up to a healthy point. So that's all, thank you.
Democracy again, can have a vision and ownership related with questions. I think they can. I don't know if that in the current crisis you need to focus only on the short term. There are examples, how to do to be part of the research team that did a research exercise about R&D as a strategy that works in the crisis, and we looked at previous examples like Finland or South Korea during the financial crisis. And actually, both of them undertook major long-term reforms during the crisis. In 1993, Finland undertook the most major educational reform in its history. And while in crisis, it was a major crisis as well. In Finland, the economy reached 18%, they lost 13% of GDP in 3 years, which is the same about Korea. And it's completely the way they were doing education research. As a result, between 1993 and 2000, they doubled the university enrollment in Finland. And I think you will know perhaps that every year they top these projects. And if this during crisis, actually research and development was the only item. They also did a fiscal consolidation exercise in order to bring expenditures. The only item that did not touch and actually increased during crisis was R&D and educational expenditures. South Korea did the same thing. It changed actually its basic economic model during the crisis,
because R&D was to be done by Cybol, funded by Cybol, the big conglomerates in South Korea before the crisis, and this was also before the crisis, did not have money to do that, they were badly hit by the crisis. And what is great, actually, the South Korean government tried to instigate a new business model to raise funding for small and medium-sized companies to fund new innovative projects. And they had a spectacular success. Before the crisis in South Korea, there were about 100 projects per year funded by small venture capital, small innovative projects. In 2001, only 3 years after the crisis, in that year alone, there were 11,000 projects funded in this way. So I think you can do, they can be part of the next strategy, and they can yield results quite soon if done quickly and wisely. I think the major issue which links with the data accessibility issue is political will, mentality, and politicians that we have been running the country for many decades. It's up to them, really. They can take ownership right now, although it's difficult. But they have to change their mentality. Data accessibility links in what I said before. I don't agree with what everyone said. I links in with what I was saying as well for the way phones were designed in Greece before the crisis, particularly. It's the same kind of issue, really. You know, if you don't want to, it's about power, really. Ministers acting like, you know, treating ministries like small fields, like to keep control of that. If you have to go to experts to tell you what to do, then you give them the power over what's the best course to follow. It's very difficult to backtrack, but we have quite reasons for not following their advice. A similar kind of reason, I think, yes, it's the same thing of hiding data, as you said. It's the mentality of the political leader of the country during these past decades. And I'm afraid to say, I think things have been changing for the best during the crisis, but I'm afraid to say it's happened out of more depression than actually of the willingness of people to own the reforms. I think this is changing, but I hope it continues. What else? The fairy wish. Well, I wish there was such a wish, but I don't think there's any. Because there's not one thing that you want, you have too many things. I agree with Theoharis that going abroad to the ministry is a good thing, but only if you do it by choice. If you do it by necessity, it's a completely different thing. Even let's suppose they come back, okay? Because I was abroad, I came back, it was a little bit quick, they won't come back. And then you get stuck. Even if they fund you for yourself, for example, they have to redesign the system and deal with the bureaucracy. I mean, the only will tell you that it has several major projects worth millions of euros, research projects, have been stuck because of bureaucratic reasons in the university. You have to deal with that. You have to deal with the fact that if you invent something, you don't have a friend to do a spin-off or some way to actually, you know, get something out of it. There are so many problems, so many levels. Actually, that research I was talking about, the preliminary results in summer, have shown that people that were abroad came back during the crisis and left again because they were frustrated. Have said that they will not ever come back again. So they want to try to come back and then have to leave again for a second time. Said, we're done with the peace. We don't want to come back. And this is a very describing thing. So we'll see. Look at that last. Thanks.
Just a quick remark on what Tony's and Zella asked before, and Kitas. There's a great book written by Hofstede and Minko. It's called Cultures and Organizations. The book is based on a survey conducted over a 4-year span in more than 70 countries. They try to assess cultural behaviors of adults in these 70 countries. Guess what? Not surprisingly, the Greeks are world champions in uncertainty. And the backbone of this uncertainty is that they believe that the social and political fabric in our country is extremely weak. They think that there are no rules in our country and every time they wake up in the morning, they fight, they have to fight against chaos. This article was concluded in 2009 before the crisis. So to answer back, I think that what would make young people return to their country would be a sense of a polity that works, that have laws, and these laws are implemented, these laws are universal. The reason why we are all contented with the fact that some members of the Golden Law are put in jail is that we witness that the state is back. We know that we have a government. We don't feel that this sense of lawlessness is everywhere. Going back to Nikita's question, I think that the process to formulate a long-term vision in the middle of the crisis requires social and scientific and political dialogue. This is exactly what's happening here today. You cannot have a high-level dialogue when the political climate, the political environment is polarized between a radical left and a populist right, and there is nothing in between. You need to have balances in the political spectrum and in the political arena if you want to have some moderate voices. And you can act in civil society. So I think it's a long and painful process, but I think it's already happening. And Adonis, regarding the additional political cost in the middle of a reform typhoon, there's something in leadership studies called holding environment. Leaders create a holding environment. They define the policy space and they fight for it, even if there's chaos everywhere. And state of Pantelis government, and this is something I had the opportunity to discuss with him in the US, is that although his government had no corruption record, they never gave a fight against corruption. They preferred to apply the program and put all the reforms inside the inside the Troika memorandum. So when it comes to this, let's go back to the late 70s in the UK, and remember what Margaret Thatcher did. Margaret Thatcher created a public environment and gave a fight in this public environment.
Thank you for being here. Enjoy the rest of your
stay. Works to wrap up our gathering today and some practical information for the rest of the day. So we have touched a lot the various challenges and problems that the EU is facing right now, and we talked about the new reforms at the European Union level and the challenges that certain countries like Greece here are facing. We didn't, I think, and perhaps this is the context that we could discuss later on today, dinner, the wider, the global context. So we see centrifugal forces within the EU. We have the referendum in Scotland. We have, obviously, in Spain, Catalan, and in other places. And we see that there are centrifugal forces within the EU that challenge some of the premises that we had taken for granted for almost 50 years. And of course, we can't decide to be or remain, you know, little Englanders, little Greeks, little Irish, little Dutch, wave our sovereignty, yes, between each other, but also to the emerging powers of this world. Of course, the powers, China, India, what they will do back, it's they will smile and they will wave their power. Now the question is, and this is the choice that we have, whether we want to face that challenge that is coming on our own or together. So this is that's why I think we all understand of the need for a new European narrative that will make the process, you know, it will convince, first of all, the people of the need to stay together and move forward. So before I move on to the practicalities, obviously, of the rest of the day, I would like to, obviously, thank, let's begin with our sponsors, Desidenti Consultants, the Regional Fund for Development in Crete, Europe Direct, and, of course, personally, Kyriakos, and the team of Kiani Beach Hotel for their impeccable hospitality once again this year. And of course I would like to thank you all for participating, but please allow me this to try to do it in, you know, follow the use Loki
following the try to an attempt, an impromptu attempt by an Athenian to render a Madinada, a Cretan couplet in English. Okay. So, we thank you all for joining us in Kianiv this year. And all the problems we discussed, we hope will disappear. So, now the practical questions, issues are, first of all, the panelists of the previous panel and those of the panelists of the last panel, if you could please stay back for some interviews. And then the practical information, the last of the day, is that the bus leaves from the reception at 6:30. So enjoy the rest of the day, and thank you very much for coming.